Hello, my name is Caleb Smith with the Rocket Miner newspaper, here to provide your news update for July 26, 2020. Today we mentioned that Hurricane Hanna was getting close to shore. It has since struck and been downgraded to tropical storm. Typically happens once it hits land. While there are certainly flood surges going on, and you can see some spectacular pictures or video out there. As of this hour, there hasn't been any reporting of deaths either in the United States or Mexico. Swatching oceans, Hurricane Douglas is swirling, quote, uncomfortably close to Hawaii, as the Associated Press reported, specifically citing Robert Ballard with the Central Pacific Hurricane Center. It's a Category 1 hurricane, which it's said to have a potential trajectory that would put it close to Oahu and even make a direct hit on the island, which is the island where Honolulu is stationed, the state capital. And other news. Yesterday I didn't mention coronavirus figures, so I should do so today. We're up to 2,029 lab confirmed cases in the Cowboy State, according to the Wyoming Department of Health, in addition to 446 probable cases, 25 people who've had COVID-19 related deaths. Breaking it down by counties, Sweetwater County is now the fourth highest caseload according to confirmed cases, sitting at 203 confirmed cases and 12 probable. We had been fifth for a consistent amount of time, but squeaked ahead of Uinta, which is now taking the number five spot with 186 confirmed cases and 47 probable. Granted, you throw those in, that might make a difference. We also have, don't you hate it when you bookmark something and then your eyes slips? Teton County with 241 lab confirmed cases, 38 probable. Laramie County with 289 lab confirmed cases and 126 probable. And Fremont, which has the highest rates in the state with 396 lab confirmed cases, 57 probable. On the Wyoming Department of Health website, there are six statewide metrics that Governor Mark Gordon and the state health officer, Dr. Alexia Harris, have consistently cited as things that they are specifically looking at as they make decisions on the current health orders in place, especially the ones that determine sizes of what we can do. At one point we'd had, and it's ranked on a green light, yellow light, red light system. And presently we don't have any cases in the green light. That was something that has changed as of late. Most of them are in the yellow, and yellow means stable. Green means improved. Red means concerning. And the areas that remain in the red are new cases and total COVID-19 admissions reported by Wyoming hospitals. We're stable in the total hospital bed availability and total ICU, intensive care unit, bed availability. Stable with percent of cases attributed to community spread, and stable with percent of all tests with a new positive result in the previous 2 weeks. That's just saying Wyoming still consistently has fairly low percentage rate out of a 100 tests. It's best if you only have like two or three people tested coming out positive. Wyoming's rate remains fairly low compared to other places. The state stresses they are constantly revisiting our numbers. If they found out that there's a false positive, they deduct those figures out and just work to make sure that they have as accurate numbers as possible. Nobody's perfect, but the fact that they keep updating cases gives me some confidence in them. Johns Hopkins University is reporting when it comes to the United States, we're now up to 4,229,624 cases total. That includes 146,909 people who have died. For up until today, we'd had 5 days in a row where the U.S. death toll had surpassed 1,000. It declined a little bit today. It looks like it was about 900 cases, more than yesterday. Overall, we're now up to 16,196,314 total confirmed cases, and 647,784 deaths. Recoveries, we're now at 9,344,883, and that includes 1,297,863 people who have recovered. Just a couple more things to note. If you watched the video last weekend, or maybe if you've seen some of the positive chatter online, you may have seen how the Rocket Miner was happy to print an award-winning essay by Celeste Keelan, a local student, a graduate of Rock Springs High School, who plans to be going on to bigger and brighter things. She wrote on the theme, how a local historical event or person impacts my life. I personally shared the essay this weekend, but if you haven't gotten the chance to get into the print edition yet, I'd encourage you to check that out. The working in coordination with the Sweetwater County Historical Museum, who was sponsoring the scholarship and essay contest to begin with, we were able to get quite a number of pictures to go with that. So you could, there's some times when I'm working with the designer and I go and I get a look at a page and I'm like, that is something that is just gonna knock the pants off the family. They're gonna be over the moon for that. I hope, based on feedback we've gotten thus far, I'm optimistic. And like I said, it just gives you a little bit chance how she just goes into how the various people who have, her predecessors who were drawn to this area and then worked with the energy industry, taught her lessons, taught her traditions. If you want to be able to get a better look at some of those faces and maybe even recognize a few. In addition to some local landmarks, I'd encourage you to check that out. Also, speaking of history, today is the anniversary, 30th anniversary of the Americans with Disability Act. President George W. Bush signed the ADA into law on July 26, 1990. The law is meant to expand equal opportunities to individuals with disabilities. And has been applied to many areas ranging from education, employment, healthcare, transportation. If you have the chance, I'm seeing it out there in some circles. The one of the award-winning documentaries at the Sundance Film Festival this past spring was called Crip Camp, which talks about many of the, it features a alternative camp that was for people with special needs, people who wouldn't be accepted by a lot of other camps, and how it's taught them how to not define themselves merely by what they lacked or define themselves by the way other people did, and how what started just as a summer camp became a political movement, and how many of these people formed lifelong friendships and starting a crusade and helped pass the Americans with Disability Act. If you have the chance to catch the movie, please do. It was one of the most striking screenings I saw at Sundance. And speaking of living history and what's coming ahead, we are 100 days away from the US election. So please be keeping an eye on that. We at the Rocket Miner are preparing our election guide for the primary election. In addition to keeping our eye on the big day, now is the time to ask questions of the candidates, to research the issues. If you wish, request an absentee ballot. I've done that myself. I appreciate how it's some of the fail-safe capabilities like barcodes and whatnot to keep it from being duplicated by somebody else. We'll be looking to get a little bit more in depth from the Rocket Miner soon on that. We're just, this is going to be a different election between the more limited polling stations, if it's anything like it's been most of the elections we've already had the mid-year, absentee ballots are going to, mail-in ballots are going to be a lot more prevalent, and those take time to process. If that's one reason why, if you are going to vote that way, I'd encourage you to vote early, get your name, get your ballot in. We really don't want to have a rehash of some past elections where we wake up the next morning and there's still some uncomfortable questions lingering as to who's president and how close is the vote. Do we need to do a recount? What do we need to do to be safe? We'll see how that turns out. Anyway, my name is Caleb Smith with the Rocket Miner newspaper, wishing you a good day and a safe tomorrow.